My talk does not unfortunately contain any black holes. It contains a lot of loopholes, and I hope that those will be then filled by Flaminia in her follow-up talk. So I start with the summary of my talk, because then you can decide whether you continue with your emails or continue listening. So here's the three summary points. There are a few tabletop experiments to date that probe the interface between classical physics, between quantum physics and classical gravity. In all these experiments, it's actually typically Earth's gravity that serves as a constant classical background field to probe the effect of gravity on those quantum systems. So loosely speaking, the quantum systems actually act as test masses in the external gravitational field. On the other hand, during the last, by now almost two decades, we have seen extremely large progress in controlling the quantum behavior of solid state objects. So we're talking micromechanical resonators, so small spheres. Tomek has given a nice introduction also in what LIGO is doing. And these systems, that's the claim now, may lead to a new class of gravitational quantum physics experiments, namely experiments in which the quantum system acts as a source mass in the experiments, as a gravitational source mass. So the experimental challenge, this is mainly what I'm going to talk about, lies now in meeting these extreme requirements that you can imagine of both achieving large mass and long coherence times, large mass to have sufficiently strong gravitational coupling, long coherence times to have time for the experiment to proceed. And the conceptual challenge, so this I will then hand over to Flaminia, lies in finding maybe hopefully less demanding and yet similarly meaningful tests for probing how gravity reacts in the presence of a quantum system. Huh? Well, that's it. Questions? Yeah. So it's really, okay, now let me start. It's, and I have to say that it was said today already by several people, it's so amazing to have you all here in presence. It's just a different way, and I guess only after the last 2 years, we do appreciate how important this kind of interaction is. And it has always been the case that those type of personal meetings focusing on certain topics has led to new insights, new directions. So let me give you an historic example. It's the 1950s, and gravity physics is definitely not a topic anymore. Everything that could have been published has been published. Everything that is being submitted at the time is typically crackpot theory, anti-gravity, and so on. At the same time, there are also some foundations of quantum physics is gaining increasing interest. And so at the time, the type of submissions to the FISREF were so, let's say, intellectually challenging to some that the then editor-in-chief of FISREF, this was Sam Goudsmit, a solid-state physicist, had it made clear that he will now issue an editorial banning all submissions in gravity and other fundamental physics for the FISREF. And it was actually due to a behind-the-scenes effort of John Wheeler that this editorial never appeared. And one of the things that John Wheeler did was he was lobbying for bringing together people for an in-person conference to talk about the role of gravitation in physics. Because it was simply, let's say, the road was undefined where to go. And this was the by now famous, this then turned into the by now famous Chapel Hill conference. As is usual, as everyone has to do, they had to find money. Bryce and Cecile DeWitt volunteered for hosting the conference. They actually, the plan was to start a new center on gravitational physics in Chapel Hill. And John Wheeler wrote a fantastic letter to Benson to lobby, so to basically raise funds. And I just want to read that briefly to you, because it reflects so nicely what this is all about, what we are talking here. So he writes in this letter, "The absence of any paradox or discrepancy in gravitation theory at the human and astronomical levels creates an obligation to apply Einstein's ideas down to smaller and smaller distances. One must check as one goes until one has either a successful extension to the very smallest distances or a definite contradiction or paradox that will demand revision. The challenge cannot be evaded. Exactly how to proceed is a matter of wisdom, skill, judgment, and a good idea. Nobody guarantees to have a good idea, but the De Witts fortunately have a very sound plan of what to do while searching for a good idea. This was sufficient to get the money to start the center and the conference, the inaugural conference in Chapel Hill, which brought together at the time everyone who was working in gravitational physics and field theory in gravity, and there was like 30 people in the world. And some of the main questions for us most relevant that were discussed back then were the following two. Do gravitational waves exist? And it was actually Pirani at that conference who made the decisive argument for it. And the second one, do we require a quantum description of gravity? These were the two main questions. The first one, now 60 years later, we do have an answer. The second one, this is what my talk is going to be about. So, how do we approach this question of the quantum nature of gravity? So, first of all, just be reminded, we have no experiment today that answers the question whether gravity requires a quantum description. We have lots of quantum theories of gravity, but no experiment that tells us whether these theories are actually necessary to describe how nature does it. So, there are currently, if you look in literature, there are essentially two approaches. Number one is the approach to say, oh, we assume there exists a quantum theory of gravity. There we go. There are many different ways of doing it. Just, for example, just applying regular quantum field theory to gravitational field and so on. And we now probe the low energy consequences of such a quantum theory gravity, which means we do an experiment in the lab and look at the consequences that these theories predict for lab scale experiments. And that typically does not require any gravity measurements, because those consequences are typically on the dynamical side. You measure modifications to an effective Hamiltonian in the dynamics of a large system or whatever. So there are many, many, many possibilities. None of that typically involves any gravity measurements.
Oh. So it would be not. In some senses, you know, if you really look at what typically in field theory people say low energy consequence, it's something that where you have your microscopic Hamiltonian is a very, very high energy scale, and you look at emergent degrees of freedom and things like that. But you don't have that.
So let me make thanks. Yes, yes. Let me make it more precise. We look at the linearized regime of the corresponding field theory in the energy range of our experiments. Okay, so low energy means targeted to the energy regime we have in the experiment. And there are several publications here that you can see where those consequences have been predicted for different types of quantum theories of gravity, and there are also some experiments. That's not what we are interested in. The second approach to probe the quantum nature of gravity is to assume nothing about how quantum physics and gravity interact, and just directly probe the consequences of a quantum configuration of gravitational source masses. Okay? And that, of course, requires gravity measurement. So now we are back to Tomek's story in the morning, where we just say, okay, now we have gravitational source masses, and we start making them quantum. And now the question is, what happens? Okay? Just for historic completeness, let me mention, but all of you know that, of course, there is a great manifold of fantastic experiments out there that do tell us how quantum systems react to gravity. As I just said, to external gravitational fields. This was the first part of my summary. And all of these experiments are very well understood in the context of typically standard quantum theory. And let's say extreme case quantum field theory on a curved space-time. Two examples that many of you may know. One is the famous experiment by Colela, Oberhauser, and Werner, the so-called Kao experiments, after the initial of the authors, where they where they show the impact of Earth's gravitational field on the wave packet of a neutron that is here sent through a neutron interferometer. So the main idea is that the neutron wave packet acquires a dynamical phase while it traverses through the classical gravitational field of the Earth. And in order to probe this phase, you want to acquire phase difference. And the way you do that is you rotate this interferometer in the gravitational field of the Earth such that the two paths acquire two different phases. And hence, as a function of the tilt angle and therefore height difference, you acquire interference fringes due to gravity, which also shows you that you need this position-dependent gravitational field in order to accumulate this Kao phase, as of the discussion that we had this morning. The other possibility, another beautiful experiment, is by the Weinlands group, where you look at gravitational redshift directly in an experiment, and it's such a beautiful experiment because you see it here essentially. So they have an optical clock experiment on an optical table, and they measure a certain frequency, and then they lift the table up. You see that here, just with the car checks, and then accordingly the frequency changes. And this is a lift of 30 centimeter of the table that then generates the change in frequency. Nowadays, these optical clocks have I think something like 4 or 5 orders of magnitude higher precision, means you're becoming more and more precise to gravitational field differences, height differences. So question that we want to ask is, what about now quantum systems as gravitational source masses? I showed you quantum systems as test systems in gravitational fields. We want to ask now, how does gravity react to quantum systems? One of the key players at the Chapel Hill conference was Feynman, and he was the one who at the conference proposed a very beautiful Gedanken experiment in which a spherical object, a massive spherical object, is, by using a type of Stern-Gerlach device, put in a spatial superposition of two locations of the center of mass degree of freedom of the object. Then you let the object's mass interact with a second system via gravity, and what's going to happen is, what we expect from a quantum physics point of view, is that the two masses become entangled. There are other very nice discussions on the topic. For example, in the de Witt fast shift by Belunru, there's a beautiful discussion in the context of a Schrödinger cat experiment where the coherent evolution of such a superposition of two massive systems is studied. We focus now on the Feynman-Gedanken experiment. And just to bear in mind, once again, what we have is here, we have here object number one placed in a superposition in the center of mass degree of freedom by this Stern-Gerlach device, and then we switch on the gravitational coupling between these two objects, so mass one and mass two. Okay. Now, from a quantum physics point of view, and this was Tomek's argument all along this morning, of course we expect entanglement to be generated, so we cannot even think otherwise. what the mediator is, even for classical, okay, well, I take that back. entanglement will be generated. However, from a GR perspective, the situation is different. From a GR perspective, remember that the source mass does nothing else than defining the overall space-time in which a test mass then moves along a geodesic. Okay? So if now even a quantum source mass would produce a well-defined space-time metric, the test mass would always follow the geodesic along this well-defined well-defined metric and would never become entangled with the source mass configuration, yeah? because the geodesic is well-defined. So in order for entanglement to be generated, you will require a superposition of space-time, yeah? Of the metric itself, which is why this is interesting also from a GR perspective. And this has been pointed out by Marios Christodoulou and Carlo Rovelli recently too. Okay, now I'm moving slowly towards the experiment. What are the possibilities? How can we generate entanglement using gravity? Yeah, well, first of all, so there are two possibilities. I show them here. Number one, this is essentially what, we ask now the question. Louis Witten was also at the Chapel Hill conference, so the father of Ed Witten, and he asked, what prevents this, or Feynman, this Gedanken experiment, this from becoming a practical experiment? This is essentially what we want to do. Okay, so here's number one. Your two masses are simply harmonic oscillators. Yeah, that's it. And they couple via gravity. Yeah? In second order, the coupling, the 1 over r potential here that you get in second order has the xx term, and the xx term for two harmonic oscillators just generates entanglement between the two, full stop. You can compute the rate at which this happens. It's a two-line calculation, and you see that the rate here, this rate here that generates entanglement between the two harmonic oscillators is of the following type. You have a prefactor, then it scales with mass times the spread of the wave packet of your oscillator, okay, and with the distance between that separates the two. Okay? So it's the delocalization of your wave packet of each of the oscillator that determines the strength. In a way, classically, that's also clear. If you drive with large amplitudes, then you increase the coupling in a 1 over r potential. So that's sort of the quantum version. You have a large delocalization. So it helps to have large delocalization. This is what... Yeah, sure. That's also classically valid, yes. So this is what Tomek said today, that the entanglement is larger when the squeezing is larger. In essence, if your delta x is large, then you have a squeezed wave packet, and you can increase it. Okay. Now, the second way of generating the entanglement is you do a Cauchy-type experiment. But instead of, so you have a quantum test system in a superposition, a spatial superposition to start off with. Now here is Earth, so your second, your source mass, but the source mass is also in a superposition. Each of the two locations of your source mass generates a phase shift. If this phase shift is essentially, can become up to pi, then what you have is, for the quantum information people, a conditional sine gate. Yeah, that's a C sine gate. If you start off with your target qubit in a superposition, then, and your control qubit is also in a superposition, you generate entanglement with a C sine gate. That's exactly what you have. In that case, the phase is the Cauchy phase that you acquire. Yeah, and in this, again, the position dependence here, this is your dynamic phase. And again, you do, in that case, the calculation is like 5 lines instead of 2 lines. But the whole point is that the rate at which you generate this entanglement between the two masses is the same. Yeah? So you have two completely different systems. The one is two coupled oscillators. The other one is two qubits, both gravitationally coupled through just a 1 over r potential. Entanglement rates are the same. So now it boils down to your taste a little bit. Okay, so would you rather like to produce large squeeze states of harmonic oscillators or large macroscopically this superposition of macroscopically distinct center of masses and do the experiment? But rate-wise, it's the same. Okay. Next question. I just continue and then. I just started, by the way, okay? but it's always, yeah, I make the point nonetheless. Okay. So here's our rate. Okay. That we just, you believe me, derived. And let's say, of course, this is larger. This has to be larger than the coherence rate, than the decoherence rate, in order to do something meaningful. And let's say we are really good experimentalists, so we say this is on the order of one. Okay, so a second. Yeah, we are so good experimenters, we can do a quantum experiment on the scale of a second. That's already pushing it. I would rather do 10 to the minus 3 here. But let's say this is a, you know, this is an outlook talk. Okay. So a second is sort of on the safe side. Okay. So let's also assume that our D, okay, the distance between the two, remember D is the distance between the two, is somewhere, I start here. Our D is somewhere, let's say a micrometer. Okay. 10 to the minus 6 meter. That's how far, that's how close I can bring it. Let's also assume that our delta x over d, so the delocalization, the relative delocalization, okay, relative to the distance that I have, is, I don't know, on the order of 10 to the minus 1. That's already pushing it. Right? As I'm saying, I can delocalize by like 100 nanometers. Okay? Let's see. If we had that, then see what happens. So then our G, okay, our G is then approximately G over H bar is 2 pi times 10 to the 23. Then you have a 10 to the 6 from the 1 over D, and you have a 10 to the minus 2 from the delta X over D squared. And then you have a mass square, okay? So this is something like 6 times 10 to the, what is it, 27. Okay, mass squared, and this should be larger than order one. Yeah? Which means that your mass, and so if this number is smaller, things become even worse, right? Yeah, here's the rate. So the rate, that means this would become larger than to the 3, than to the 4. So this all is becoming worse. So I'm giving you a best case scenario. So you see what then happens. So that means that the mass squared needs to be larger than order 1 over 6, 10 to the minus 27. No? Isn't that right? So this is something on the order of 1.2 times 10 to the minus 14 squared. And the whole thing in kilogram. It's all as I units. Okay? Which also means now that the density of your matter lump, yeah, that you need to have, is definitely on the order of the mass divided by, well, as a volume, let's say, again, optimistically, the volume should be smaller than D, the separation, right? So density has definitely to be in the order M to the D cubed, approximately. Which means you go here, 10 to the minus 14 divided by, you see, 10 to the minus 18, which gives you approximately 10 to the 4 kilogram per cubic meter, which is solid state densities. So this is the argument why for these type of experiments, no matter how you turn it, you should use a solid state object. And it's, you're going to have a really, really hard time if you want to use gases or other objects as your quantum objects. Okay, so now I start, okay? That was the prelude, but now I'm fast. Reality check. Where are we? So I told you where we want to go, and I told you what is required. So question is now, where are we at the moment? So this is where we are. This plot here shows you coherence time versus mass in current experiments where the center of mass degree of freedom is used in coherent superpositions. Okay. And we start with the first question. How small can we make a gravitational source mass? Okay. If you look at current gravity experiments, okay, gravity doesn't have a y-axis here, so there's no coherence in current experiments. And if you look in the literature, the smallest source mass to date is on the order of a gram. Right, where people in the lab have really put a 1 gram mass and then measured the gravitational field of a 1 grandmas. Now, the question was, well, how small can we actually go? So here is the idea. So we came from this, well, from our experience with micromechanical systems, and we thought, well, a micromechanical system is a good sensor. So what we could do is we could have just a mass here on a micromechanical system here that we then just read out optically, okay? And here is our source mass. And the idea is now, when the source mass is small, what you can do is you can shake it. Okay, so typical experiments, I just show you briefly here, this is one of my favorite experiments of the Edelberger group in Washington. So typically we're talking here about kilogram masses that are very slowly moved, if at all, okay, or maybe just displaced. So the idea was, well, if you have a small mass, you know, you can just as a function of here, as a function of time, you can just shake it, and therefore you have a time-dependent gravitational force or acceleration at the location of your test mass, and you just ring it up and measure it. Right, that was the idea. We did some back on the envelope calculations. If the thermal noise limit of this oscillator is our noise floor, what can we do? And so we came up then at the end with the following type of parameters. So as you see, first the idea, so the distance here between the two, the distance between the two is modulated as a function of time. So it's just a sinusoidal modulation in the experiment, okay? Accordingly, this generates acceleration of the test mass towards the source mass that has now, since it's a non-linear potential that you're modulating, has not only linear, but also higher order responses to the whole thing. So you not only have a response of the test mass with the driving frequency, but you also have higher order terms. You get double the frequency, triple the frequency, and so on. And the parameters that we chose in the end was we started with a gold mass on the order of a millimeter radius. So that's approximately, you see, 9 × 10⁵ kilogram. The distance between the two was 4 millimeter, and the modulation amplitude here was 1.6 millimeter, which means that the smallest distance here between the two during the experiment was in the order of 400 micrometer, okay, between the two surfaces. The overall acceleration modulation that you expect in the experiment is on the order of 10⁻¹g, so 10⁻¹ meter per second squared, which corresponds to a displacement of our mass in our experiment on the order of nanometer. So this is what we had to resolve. Okay, we are looking for nanometer displacement when this mass here is modulated by 2 millimeters as a response. Okay, so to make a long story short, since we are so displacement on sensitivity, it's clear that all other noise sources play a role. For example, the traffic light. It's very super. So we have a road crossing around 70 meters away from our lab. And we plot here, as you can see, here's the frequency. Here's the time. And the color encoding is amplitude in our experiment. So dark blue is small amplitude. Yellow is high amplitude. And you see these stripes at 10⁻²⁰ hertz. And higher orders of that is actually the traffic light cycle down at the road crossing. So it switches like with 10 millihertz. So that means that whenever the cars accelerate, whenever the pedestrians start to walk, whenever the tram starts to accelerate, we get a signal. Okay. The dark lines here, the vertical ones, this is where the tram stops. Yeah, so there's no tram traffic. This is the 5-hour window during the night where nothing happens. And you see, there's also always two lighter lines. No, there's always one, two, three, four, five dark lines and the two lighter lines. Yeah? So this is Friday night and this is Saturday night. People are out on the street. Yeah? And then it's again Sunday, everyone goes home and so on. And then we have again. Okay, so this is the type of stuff we are dealing with. Vienna City Marathon, a nightmare. Yeah, I mean, the finishing line is like 2 miles away from our experiment. We saw the winner entering the incredible. Okay, and one more thing, it turns out, so what you see here is Tobias actually took his phone, and so this is a Google map. If he follow, basically he rode the tram. Okay, so this is like a typical, this is the typical way the trams go when they pass our lab. Here's our lab somewhere. Where's our lab? Here's our lab. Okay, this is how the trams go. So what you can do now is you can project the Newtonian gravitational attraction of the tram. It's 90 tons, 90, okay? A Vienna tram is 90 tons. And it passes our lab here, close proximity, 60 meters. You can calculate, so project the gravitational attraction, the gravitational pull of the tram onto our test mass. Okay? The problem is that the frequency at which this happens is close to our resonance frequency of the experiment. It's the stupid 10 millihertz. That's the traffic light cycle that also the trams have. And it turns out the distance is close enough that the mean pull is on the same order of magnitude than the actual gravitational acceleration due to our small 1 millimeter gold mass next to it. Luckily, of course, here Tomek again. No, it's the force gradient in our experiment. So basically both source and test mass are being pulled. Yeah, so we are not sensitive. We would have to have a gradient on the scale of our experiment. But the point is, if we would have had a different experimental configuration, not using a torsional balance like we did, we would be fully limited by the Newtonian noise of our trams. Anyway, this just shows you that these experiments, gravity, small gravitational fields is subtle because you just cannot shield it from other influences, in particular not other gravitational influences. So long story short, here's the results, which not surprisingly were taken during the Christmas time. Okay. And you can nicely see, just focus here on the, actual yellow and red line. Yellow, it is the force residual. So this is actually force in femtonewtons, and, red are the force signals. So you have actually the force is down here. And then you have here at the modulation frequency of the source mass, we have a nice signal that corresponds to what you expect from Newtonian. And we even see the second order modulations, a higher order from the non-linearity of the gravitational potential. You can also map out the full 1/r and so on and so on. But the nice thing is now, that the acceleration modulation we're sensitive to is on the order of 10 to the minus 11 g. And the precision of the experiment is on a 1% level. Okay, so we do have acceleration precision on the level of 10 to the minus 13 g in this experiment. So 10 to the minus 12 meter per second squared. And the accuracy is 10%. The systematics, Gregor has told you everything about systematics in his talk. In our case, it was a bit larger, 10%. But the point is that we do find gravitational coupling. The systematics we all understand. So basically, we can state that less than 10% of our signal is due to non-gravitational forces, or gravitational sources not coming from the source mass that we have, and that means that we can be sure that we isolated gravitational coupling from a 90 milligram source mass. Oh no.
What duration do you average down to this value, and will it average more if you kept going?
Yes. So this was averaged over 30,000 seconds. Okay.
10 hours.
Yeah. And then right now, still, I mean, if you look at the Allen deviation, then we start to. Then long-term drifts simply saturate us. Yeah. Which is why, thank you for the question, we have moved the experiment now to the Conrad Observatory, which is an underground tunnel system in Lower Austria. It's about 50 miles to the south west from here. And as you can nicely see, so this is almost freshly digged tunnel for inertial and magnetic measurements. with an amazing stability. So we already had first test runs and we already see a 3 orders of magnitude decrease in the background signal. What we have, so our experiment is built directly here on this concrete block here. Temperature stability, it's a constant 7 degrees with for the experimentalists with a millikelvin stability because no one enters these things. And humidity is 100%. That's an interesting experimental challenge, but a fun one. Okay, so if I still have the time, I come to the main part of my talk. Until 5, I thought until 4. which is this part, okay? And so I'm going to skip now the references to my dear colleagues because the chairman does not allow me more time. And I go directly into showing you 2 examples where, let's say, a large product of delocalization and mass has been achieved. Because remember, this is the essential term in the coupling, delta x times m squared. So here my favorite experiment by Markus Arndt here also in Vienna, macromolecule interference, where you have delocalization of an incredible 500 nanometers, okay, of approximately 10 to the 4 atoms in the molecule, which means delta x times m is on the order of 10 to the minus 29. Solid-state mechanical oscillators, this was an experiment 10 years ago by the Cleland group, where they looked at the thickness oscillation of an aluminum nitride resonator plate. So it was really acoustic modes in this thing. They coupled it to a qubit, and they could generate superposition between the ground state and the first excited state of these acoustic oscillations, resulting in Ramsey interference fringes. So you can could really show that you had a superposition of all the atoms sitting in one position in the lattice and at another position at the lattice. So there was a displacement. The displacement was small. If you calculate it, it's more sub-femtometer, but you could see Ramsey interference. So it was a measurable interference. Delta X is super small in this experiment. The mass, however, is super large compared to the other one. So, funnily enough, delta X times M in this experiment is also 10 to the minus 29. Okay. The only difference is, of course, in the end, this thing has to exceed the decoherence rate. So it's actually this times the coherence time that is the relevant number. Okay. And of course, this is a second in a molecule experiment and it's a nanosecond in the solid state experiment. So there's 9 orders of magnitude still difference between those two. Now, what we want to do is we want to combine these two types of experiments. We want to combine the large mass of solids and the beauty of long coherence times of the metawave experiments. How do you do that? Well, the main idea is you levitate your solid state objects. You start with the with a solid, and then you confine it into a trap, into a potential that is totally engineerable externally, such that you can use all the advantages, for example, confine it to an harmonic potential and then just laser cool it, for example, to the ground state, then you have a pure state wave packet, and then switch it off, have free evolution, and so on and so on. Okay, so you combine the advantage of free dynamics of a single particle with the large mass, high density, let's say it's the relevant part of the solid, okay? Well, the way to do that, I just give you now one example, optical levitation. This was pioneered by Ashkin. The main idea is, to, in a nutshell, you just focus down a laser beam through a microscope objective. Okay, so here's your microscope objective. You focus the laser very narrowly. And what happens, because at the end of the day, the particle is a dielectric object. So the effective potential that the particle sees in an external electric field is just d times e, no, dipole moment times electric field. Because the dipole moment is generated by the electric field, it's actually in the end just the intensity of the laser beam that defines the potential for the particle. So in other words, it's the inverse beam intensity profile of your laser that defines the potential. If your intensity profile looks almost quadratic, so Gaussian, yeah, then for small displacements it's quadratic, the inverse is just an harmonic potential. So that means a focused laser beam provides you with a 3D harmonic potential for your particle. Yeah, so, and this is how you can trap now a nanoparticle in front of a microscope objective. This is what we do. And the particles are typically on the order of, you see, 150 nanometers in diameter. So like 10 to the 8, 10 to the 9 atoms. The next thing you do is, you do exactly what we have here, here in your experimental chamber, the vacuum chamber. Then you play a couple of optics tricks. So basically the light that is transmitted here, from the tweezer, okay, this you catch, and obviously, because of the interaction with the particle, the light that is scattered in forward direction and sideways will contain information about the XYZ motion. So this you just catch, and with this information, you stabilize the particle motion. You feedback cool, in other words. And that allows you to reduce the pressure to, let's say, nice values on the order of 10 to the minus 9, with which you then do the experiments. The next thing that you do is you now focus only on the backscattered light. Yeah, so instead of using the forward scattered light, you use the backscattered light. Why? Because it contains most information about the motion along the direction of the tweezer. Light that is scattered in forward direction was absorbed and transmitted, and did in net not contribute any momentum change to the particle. So it doesn't carry any information about the position. The backscattered one puts maximum momentum change on the particle, carries maximum information. Anyway, so we do that. We do a backplane imaging in a confocal way to maximize the detection efficiency of the backscattered light here. And we do it almost at the Heisenberg limit, which means that we can now essentially monitor the trajectory of the particle with a precision that is very close to its ground state size. Okay? Which means now, since we have a real-time information about the particle with a precision of the ground state size, we can also just use that, apply a feedback force to it, and cool it to, and stabilize the motion, aka cool it to the quantum ground state of motion. That's it. And there's a little bit mathematics and control theory involved. Having a good state space model is important. That's what's called a Kalman filter. And this we have done in collaboration with the control theory group of Andreas Kugi at the TU Wien. And this allowed us then to basically cool the center of mass motion of the particle sitting in a room temperature environment down to the quantum ground state with only one half quantum. This is how it looks like. Oops, where is it? There you go. You see? This is, that's nice. It almost looks like the black hole picture, right? So I think the lesson is that every interesting figure in observational physics has like, looks the same. Ours is green, not orange, Gregor. So orange is a black hole, and green is a ground state cooled particle. So maybe let's define that. Okay, so that's how it looks like. Yeah, it's still, I know, I'm sorry, yeah. ground state size, just to give you an idea of the numbers, picometer scale. Okay, so particle is 150 nanometers. The wave packet size at this point is 3 picometers. But we have a trapped particle. So what we could do now in principle, we could just switch off the trap, just let it evolve freely. And then after 10 milliseconds of free fall, you would already be the wave packet extension on the order of the particle radius, which is something. That's would be nice. It's a good way to start. Okay, so I think that's it. I can give you numbers and so on. Next thing then, of course, would be we need to prepare then large quantum superposition states. This slide is deliberately chosen to confuse you, because it essentially tells you there are right now many approaches, none of which is yet really totally figured out, and that is the status of experiments right now. Okay, so papers will always say, theory proposals will always say, this is within the range, so this is technically feasible with current state technology, forget it. So right now we have an idea, we have different ways of possibly going, but I'm most excited right now by the fact that we think we can do it with in-trap coherent dynamics. So the particle never leaves the trap. It just stays in a trap and we do everything. Imagine the particle carries a virtual reality goggle. Okay, that's it. Yeah, so everything comes to the particle. It doesn't have to move. We do everything in the trap. Okay, good. The way we do that is we change the potential landscape. This is something we are doing in experiments. This is the last thing. We're going towards larger masses with superdong datas. And well, this is my second summary of the day. It's totally different than the first one. But as you can see, these are the two questions that we need to address in order to experimentally tackle the quantum gravity interface. How small can we make a source mass? How massive can we make a quantum system? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Markus. We have time for a few questions. Do you have somebody from online? So let's, nobody. Okay. From the audience? Jörg?
So Markus, your one of our gravitational potential is a classical field. How much could you learn from charged particles? Because there you have many orders of magnitude more things and you can play around with it. And learn something for it, or is there where do you expect to be a significant difference between, or where do you think to be a significant difference between charged particle and gravity?
So where the difference is essentially in the interpretation. So there is no geometrical interpretation in that sense that is interesting, but the similarity is striking, and this is what we are doing at the moment. So we are trying. This is for us is now the probe. For all these concepts. Okay, so the particle that I showed you here, so in this experiment, the particle is actually charged. Okay, it carries a lot of charges, and this is what we are using at the moment. Oops, sorry. This is what we are using at the moment to apply a feedback force. You see, the microscope objective is grounded, and on the lens we have a potential applied potential difference. And so we do have charges, and we can now have two particles. And we can have them interact via Coulomb, and this is and can generate entanglement. So this is right now what we are exactly trying to do: generate entanglement via Coulomb to see whether all these ideas do actually work.
Good. We have. You want to continue? Or you want to follow up? Yeah. Okay. We have one more question here.
Thank you. Okay, it's a bit of a naive question. I've heard this talk a couple of times, and every time you say, I find it extremely interesting every time too.
Yeah. You know, this was a close call now.
I always have the following question. When you say that there is this virtual landscape for the potential, let's say we do an experiment that aims to somehow detect the non-classicality of the gravitational field, then directly that word is going to create an issue, because then somebody's going to say, wait a minute, did you actually see something about the gravitational field? So I just, you see what I mean? Just want to test how you resolve that tension.
So I think this one can, in my eyes, nicely separate, because you use, when I say, we can have this dynamical potential landscape, for me, this is state preparation. Yeah, so in an experiment, you would typically distinguish the first part, state preparation, then the actual interaction, and then you do the measurement, the readout in the end. And for me, everything I'm discussing here is the state preparation of a state like that, or a large squeeze state. So basically, I want to initialize the states of the two masses, which are then ready such that if gravitational interaction would be present on top, you would see entanglement. But if gravitational interaction would not be present, you would not see entanglement. That's the way you would have to design the experiment. Right. So this is all preparation stage.
So the gravitational interaction would be something that is in addition. It's virtual practice on the preparation stage.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, very good. Markus, thank you.